Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Christ Church. My name is Nathan Miske. I'm the youth director here and one of the vicars or pastors in training. Thank you for joining us for worship here this morning at Christ Church. We are a church about lifting lives, elevating Christ, a church for those who aren't here yet. Join us now as we worship God together.
As you are, as you want to be, are you ready? Are you ready? Come now, tired, broken, scared, adjusting. Ready or not, it's all right. Take your time, if nothing else, just come.
Are you ready or not?
yet.
Are you ready? Are you ready?
Come now. Bring him praise for what he's gonna do next.
Are you ready? Are you ready on a
Good morning, Christ Church. We are glad that you are here with us, whether you are ready quite this morning or not. We're just glad that you're joining with us. And we know that wherever we are, God is already at work. And we come to remind ourselves of that this morning and to just lean into his presence, the presence of the Holy Spirit, to know that he sometimes talks to us in quiet and gentle ways. So we invite the knowledge of his presence this morning.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I tasted and see the sweetest of love.
prayer. Holy Spirit, we know that you are here in this place. We know that when we gather together, your Spirit, God, is with us. So we know whether we're gathered here in person or watching online, we know you are with us. God, help us feel your Spirit. Help us be comforted by that Spirit. That no matter what we're going through in the midst of these difficult, weird, unprecedented times, that we would know the love that you have for us. God, we pray for those people in the world making decisions, and big decisions, about big problems. God, give them wisdom, give them guidance. And for God, for each of us believers, each of us here gathered at Christ Church, or with Christ Church. God, show us who you are and show your love to us. We love you and we pray all these things in your name. Amen. Good morning once again. Thank you for joining us here at Christ Church. One of our core values here at Christ Church is radical generosity. And we can have this radical generosity because we know the radical generosity Christ has given to us. We've seen how in his life he died for our sins and rose again from the grave. So we too can have radical generosity towards others. So that's why it's one of our core values here with our time, with our energy, with our resources, and yes, even with our finances. So if you want to give, Covenant members, regular attenders, it is one of our core values. We do ask that you give. If you want to give, you can do so at christchurchmequon.life/giving. You can also give by mailing in a check. We'd love to receive your gift. However, if it's your first time joining us online, thank you so much for being with us. We never ask our first-time visitors to make a gift, so please don't feel obligated to make a gift at all, but Covenant members, regular attenders, regular online viewers, we do ask for your radical generosity. All right, big announcement here. It's already been announced, but just a reminder, August 2nd is coming, which means we are resuming in-person worship. I'm super excited about this, to be able to gather together in person with all of you, to be able to worship God together. So we'd love to have you join us August 2nd for in-person worship. Couple things to expect. It's going to look a little different. There's going to be some social distancing measures in place. Looking around this room right now, we already got it sort of set up. The chairs are a little bit further apart than you might be used to. It's going to be a touchless worship experience. We're not going to have the kids ministry open yet. We're not going to have the cafe open yet. Those are coming in September. But we want to maintain that social distancing, but we also want to gather together in person. So we're super excited about this. But if you're not yet ready, you're not yet comfortable for whatever reason for joining us in person yet, that's okay. We're going to keep going, keep continuing with the online worship and the streaming. We'd love to have you join us, whether it's in person or whether it's online, for our August 2nd worship experience. At this time, I'd ask that you turn your attention to this video as we prepare to receive Pastor Bob's message.
Good morning, Christ Church. I'm Pastor Bob, lead pastor here at Christ Church. It is great to be with you today, to be able to worship with you wherever you are. And we trust that not only is God present, but God is going to work in your life today. And we hope this message and this whole message series will change the way you pray. We're in a series called Ancient Prayers. We're looking at God's people from the Old Testament and looking at some of the more significant prayer experiences in the Old Testament and trying to glean from those just these principles, these observations that we can bring into our day, into our own prayer life, so that we can be the people, the most powerful people we can be for God's purposes. And that is absolutely going to be obvious today as we look at the ancient prayers of Solomon. Now, you may remember last week we talked about his dad, David, and now this week we move on to Solomon, and so did the throne. As David came toward the end of his life, he transferred authority and he transferred the throne over to his son Solomon. And if you go into 1 Kings and you begin to read about that transition, you'll see that Bathsheba, Solomon's mother, David's wife, and Nathan the prophet that we talked about last week, they all kind of came together with Solomon and established his throne, right? And in some ways, they did some pretty ruthless stuff, but the outcome was all the same, and that is they made sure that Solomon now sat on his father David's throne. And so Solomon is probably 19, 20 years old, something like that, and he's now king and sitting on the throne. And you can see him starting to exercise kind of his kingly authority. If you go into 1 Kings 3, it says right away that Solomon made an alliance with Pharaoh. He started making friends with other rulers out there. And of course, he did it the way they did it in those days. The way he did the alliance is that he married one of Pharaoh's daughters. And so Solomon starts making some astute political moves to ensure that his throne is secure, not only within Israel, but equally beyond, in the influence of other nations. And on the surface, we would look at that and say, wow, that was a pretty smart move, right? Pharaoh, powerful king, and now Solomon is making friends with him, marrying his daughter. Good move, Solomon, smart guy. Yes, but what we see in Solomon's life, that while it may have been a politically astute move, on a spiritual level, it puts Solomon at risk. Why is that? Well, Solomon marries Pharaoh's daughter, and as you would expect, he brings her to live into the city of David until he could finish building his palace and the temple of the Lord and the wall around the city. The Jerusalem is still in process, but Solomon brings Pharaoh's daughter, his new wife, into Jerusalem, and with her, he brings all the gods of Egypt. And that becomes the terrible tension in Solomon's life and in his reign as king. Solomon begins to struggle with absolute devotion to the one true God. And that's reflected not only in Solomon's life and in Solomon's rule, but it's also reflected just in the people of Israel themselves. It says, at that time, the people of Israel sacrificed their offerings at local places of worship, for a temple honoring the name of the Lord had not yet been built. And, you know, we look at that in our time, in our day, and say, what's the big deal at local places of worship? Well, in other translations, they call them at the high places. And what the Bible's describing there is not just the local kind of synagogues. What it's describing is these local temples, these high places of pagan worship. These high places of pagan worship. In fact, the theory was that if you wanted to ask something from your God and make sure that your God delivered what you were asking for, what you needed to do was go to a place where you could get actually closer to them. And it made sense. To do that, you go to a high place. So they went to literal high places, mountains, hills, those places that would elevate them in order to get closer to their God, and therefore that God would hear them, that God would respond to them, and they would get what they want. What do we see happening? What's happening in Solomon's reign from the beginning is the tension of divided loyalty. Divided loyalty. I mean, we see from the beginning that God expects absolute devotion. Remember when he came to Abraham, when this whole thing began, and he made that covenant with Abraham. He said, Abraham, listen, here's the deal. I'm going to be your God, right? That means nobody else is. You're not going to appeal to anybody else. You're not going to go to the high places. Nope, your devotion is absolutely to me, and I'm going to be your God, and I'm going to protect you. I'm going to provide for you. I'm going to bring you prosperity. But here's the deal, Abraham. I am going to be your God and nobody, no one else. You see, that's the covenant. That's the expectation. We have a jealous God and he expects, he desires full devotion. And from the beginning in Solomon's reign, there is this tension and this challenge of divided loyalty. And one truth, one simple reality is divided loyalty divides. How's that for great wisdom, right? It makes pretty good sense, doesn't it? I mean, divided loyalty simply divides. And that's true in our own lives as well, that while we may know and understand, hey, we are supposed to be absolutely, completely devoted to Christ. It's so easy in our lives to get other things pushing and pulling and tugging against us, and our lives get fractured and our loyalties get divided. Even though we know the best thing we can do, the most important thing we can do with our life is to stay absolutely devoted, nonetheless, there is that constant tension, that pulling at us, that tugging at us, that somehow other things in life take over. The same is true for Solomon. It says that Solomon loved the Lord and followed all the decrees of his father David, right? Solomon in his heart wants to be like David. And Bible says David was a guy after God's own heart, right? Totally devoted. Yeah, he made mistakes. Yes, he stepped out of line, but he always came back and was absolutely devoted. And Solomon loves the Lord and he wants to be that person. Except, here it is. Except Solomon, too, offered sacrifices and burned incense at the local places of worship. Solomon, the great king, not so different from us. While the call in our life is to be absolutely devoted, it is easy to have that except. There is this expectation. Except there is this opportunity. Except something else comes along. And so the challenge for us is the same challenge that Solomon faced. Now here's the good news. The good news we see that in Solomon's life and so in our lives, God is not afraid of this weakness in our life. God understands it, and he's not afraid to enter into it. How do we know? Here's what happens for Solomon. Solomon, being divided in his loyalty, it says that he went up to Gibeon. He went to one of those places of worship. In fact, it was the most important of the places of worship, and he worshiped in this pagan place. Solomon goes to the most significant place, Gibeon. And he has this divided loyalty, and it's on display for everybody to see. And it's precisely at this place, at Gibeon, that God shows up. In the most unexpected place, the real God, the one true God, the God who is asking Solomon for absolute, utter devotion, he shows up in this place where Solomon's weakness is most obvious. It says, that night, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream, and God said, what do you want? Ask, and I will give it to you. Not only does God show up in this place where Solomon's weakness is obvious and on display, but God shows up, and he offers Solomon rescue. He offers Solomon this incredible invitation. In your weakness, Solomon, what do you need? What can I supply for you? In your weakness, Solomon, How can I step in and be your God? That is incredible. And the truth is, and I absolutely believe this, God hasn't changed in that attitude. That just as God showed up in Solomon's weakness, and just as he showed up with that incredible invitation saying, Solomon, in your weakness, what do you need? The same is true today. In our weakness, in our difficulty, in our anxiousness, in our faults and in our failures, in those times when we have that divided loyalty and we follow other gods, when we make other things even more important than Christ in our life, God is not afraid of our weakness. And He still is willing to show up. And He's willing to get our life refocused and say, what do you need? What do you need in your life? It's exactly what He does for Solomon. And the response is Solomon's prayer. That's what we're going to look at now. We're going to look at this incredible, powerful experience of Solomon in this conversation and prayerful dialogue with God. And here's where it starts. Solomon's response to God's invitation is to start by just praising God for His grace. Here's what it looks like. Solomon replied, "You showed great and faithful love to your servant, my father David, because he was honest and true and faithful to you." And you could add to the end, unlike me right now. You see, Solomon just stops and recognizes what God is doing here is absolutely incredible. And it is all about God's character of grace. His just incredible love that Solomon didn't deserve. And he's saying, look, you showed that love to my father David, and now you're showing that to me. He says, and you have continued to show this great and faithful love to him today by giving him a son to sit on his throne. Solomon realizes from the beginning of this prayer that what God is offering here, what God is prepared to do here, is totally grace. It is totally God's gift. It is totally the expression of God's love for him. I mean, I think that is a great reminder to us, because so often it's so easy for us to fall into expectations that God ought to, right? That God ought to hear our prayers and He ought to give us what we want, when in truth, in reality, He doesn't have to. He's God. Solomon stops and acknowledges from the beginning that all of this, everything that's happening in this moment, in this prayer, is God's grace. And because he relies on grace, because he acknowledges God's grace from the beginning, he can equally take the next step and face his own weakness. He can acknowledge before God his own weakness in this moment. "Now, O Lord my God, you have made me king instead of my father David, but I am like a little child who doesn't know his way around." All right, how would you translate that? Maybe you translate it something like, "God, I'm king, and I'm way in over my head. Lord, you made me king, and I am absolutely not sure I'm up to the task. In fact, I know I am not up to the task." Solomon recognizes God's grace, but he always also recognizes the situation that he's in, that in and of himself, he cannot do it. What is it he can't do? He can't fulfill his purposes in life. He can't be the king God wants him to be. He can't be the person God wants him to be on so many levels. And so he pauses and he remembers God's grace. He pauses and he acknowledges the situation and his own weakness. And then he remembers with God his own purpose. He says, "And here I am in the midst of your own chosen people, a nation so great and numerous they cannot be counted." He remembers, here I am, king. And I'm not here to just be a king. I'm here to be the prince, the king that God has appointed me to be. You see, Solomon acknowledges that his life is about something bigger than just being a king. His life is about being the king for God's own chosen people. That's his purpose. He's not there just to be a king. He is there to be God's king. His life is not about himself. It's not about just being king. His life is about being the king God chooses. His life is about being the king God desires. His life is about being the king that God purposes for him. You see, Solomon pauses and remembers that life is not about him. And that is a great reminder for us, because that's the great deception, especially in our world and in our culture, to somehow convince ourselves that life is all about us, that everything is all about us, and it's all here for us. No. No, life is all about Christ. And everything that's here is for him and through him. And we exist as Christ followers. We exist not for ourselves, but we exist to advance the kingdom. We exist to fulfill his purposes. We exist to be the people that he chooses us to be. And so in Solomon's prayer, God gives him this great invitation. And he remembers it's by God's grace. And he acknowledges his own weak situation. And he reminds himself, along with God, he gets it. His life is about something bigger than himself. And all that influences what he needs to ask for. So now the big thing, what does he ask for? This tremendous invitation, what does Solomon ask for? Well, what Solomon asks for is what he needs to do what God wants. He asks for God to supply him with everything he needs to be the king that God wants him to be. Here's what it looks like. Give me an understanding heart so that I can govern your people well and know the difference between right and wrong. God, give me what I need to be that kind of king that I can govern your people the way you want me to govern your people. Give me the gifts I need. Give me what I need, a listening, understanding heart. Give me wisdom and understanding to not just decide things for my own good, for my own purposes, but to be the king that you want me to be. Because Solomon understood, for who by himself is able to govern this great people of yours? What do you ask for? You see, when you think about your friendships and your relationships, what do you ask for? You see, do you ask that God would give you what you need to be the representative of Christ in those people's lives? Do you ask in your marriage as a spouse that you can be not just a good husband or a good wife, but that you can be a godly husband and a godly wife, that you can be the kind of spouse that God would design you to be, or as a parent, to be the kind of parent that God wants you to be, or in your career, to just go ahead and do whatever it is that God has for you, what his future is for you? Solomon asks that he can be the king that God wants him to be. Now, this principle isn't simply a Solomon kind of experience. This also shows up in the New Testament as well. If you go into the book of James, it says, and even when you ask, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. You want only what will give you pleasure. See, you somehow think it's all about you. Or 1 John says, and we will receive from him whatever we ask because we obey him and do the thing that pleases him. What do we ask for? the thing that pleases Him. That's what Solomon asked for. And that's exactly the outcome. It says, the Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for wisdom. Here's a tip. Here's an insight. Write this down. Remember this one. You ready? God always does what pleases Him. He always does what pleases Him. And so Solomon asked, and he asked, and God was pleased. And so what does God do? God is ready to respond. Now, what's significant in this experience is that we also see what Solomon doesn't ask for, and God pays attention not only to what Solomon does ask for, but He also pays attention to what Solomon doesn't ask for. It says, so God replied, because you have asked for wisdom in governing my people with justice and have not asked for a long life or wealth or the death of your enemies, what do you suppose every other king out there in all the other pagan high places is asking for, right? Long life, wealth, kill my enemies, secure my throne. God's saying, listen, Solomon, I noticed not only what you asked for, but what you didn't ask for. And God was ready to respond in radical generosity. He made the invitation. He is ready to fulfill that invitation. And God responds to Solomon with incredible, radical generosity. He says, I will give you what you have asked for. I will give you a wise and understanding heart, such as no one else has had or ever will have. He responds to Solomon to give him not only what he asked for, but to give him the maximum of what he asked for. Think about Solomon. What's he known for? Wisest guy ever, right? Read the book of Proverbs, full of incredible wisdom. You see, God delivers and then some. And it gets even better. God's radical generosity doesn't just stop with saying, okay, this is what you asked for. I'm going to give you that, and I'm going to give you the best of that. But it says, and I will also give you what you did not ask for, riches and fame. No other king in all the world will be compared to you for the rest of your life. And you say, that's awesome. And it doesn't stop there. And if you follow me and obey my decrees and my commandments as your father David did, I will give you a long life. You see how radically generous God is. You see, doesn't it remind you of a New Testament statement that Jesus makes? Seek first the kingdom of God, and then all these things will be given to you as well. You see, this is the nature of who God is. When we ask to fulfill His purposes, when we ask to be the person that He wants us to be, when we focus on Him, He fulfills His promises in radical generosity. We acknowledge our weakness. We trust in His grace. We admit our inabilities. And we come to Him and just ask, God, do what pleases You. Do what pleases You. That's what Solomon did. And it ended up totally changing and refocusing Solomon's life to a life of wisdom. Now it ends with Solomon realizing that it's only been a dream. And you'd think right away, well, that's it. He thought it was only a dream. And wow, nice dream, but it's all over. No, not at all. Solomon understood that this was the presence of God working and speaking into his life. And it all ends with Solomon's life being absolutely refocused back to total devotion. Look at how it ends. He returned to Jerusalem and stood before the Ark of the Lord's Covenant, where he sacrificed burnt offerings and peace offerings. Where does he come back? This is fantastic. He comes back to the very place in Jerusalem where God's holy box, the Ark of the Covenant was, the tent, right, of meeting where God's presence was known. Solomon comes back to Jerusalem and he goes to the very place he ought to started at to begin with. Instead of going to the high places, instead of being divided in his loyalty, he comes back to that very place. Listen, for some of you this morning, this isn't just an invitation to rethink your prayer life and what you ask for. For some of you, this is the opportunity to come back, to get life refocused, to get life in absolute devotion to Christ, and to understand that when you totally focus on Christ, He'll take care of you. He'll provide for you. He'll be radically generous in your life in His own way, according to His purposes, and it will be better than anything you could ever ask for. So for us this morning, this becomes an opportunity for us to not just simply look at a prayer that Solomon prayed, but an opportunity for us to pray a prayer and be able to say, God, I'm going to rely on your grace, because my life is being pulled in so many directions, especially in this difficult time, and I cannot do it myself. So, Lord, I just want you to take hold of my life and do whatever pleases you. And I'm going to trust in your radical generosity. And I'm going to trust that you're going to use my life for something greater for your kingdom. Let's pray that together. Lord, we come to you today. We step into Solomon's shoes this morning. And we ask, trusting in your grace, knowing our weakness and our inabilities, we step in and we simply ask, we echo those words of Solomon. Lord, forgive us for those times when our loyalty has been divided. Exercise your grace in our lives. Claim us once again and do with us whatever pleases you. Use our lives. Use our homes and our marriages and our relationships. Use our careers. Use everything that we are according to your will and according to your purpose. Lord, we want to be serious about this prayer. We want to be serious about the prayer when we pray, your will be done in our lives. Lord, we trust you. We trust in your radical generosity, a generosity of love and grace and forgiveness and goodness, and that you will supply everything that we need and then some. So, Lord, refocus us in this moment. Hear our prayers and bring us into absolute devotion to you. We ask this through the strength, the presence, and trusting in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We see how God was radically generous with Solomon. And God, too, is radically generous with us. When Jesus died on the cross, he died to forgive us of our sins. And when he rose again on Easter, he rose and conquered over death, the ultimate consequence of sin. So when we confess our sins before God, we are forgiven of them. 1 John 1:8 reminds us, it says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Take a moment now to silently confess your sins to God. We know that in God's mercy, you are forgiven. Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God has forgiven you all of your sins. If we believe, we become children of God and are bestowed upon us, and what is bestowed upon us is his Holy Spirit. You are forgiven of your sins. Know this as you go throughout the rest of your week and your life. As we've shared in worshiping together today, let's also share in praying as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. A few reminders for you before we head out this morning. If you need prayer, if you want prayer for anything in your life, and you're watching live on Sunday morning, we'd love to pray with you. We have prayer partners standing by, waiting, anxious, just so excited to pray with you. You can receive that prayer by calling into our Christchurch mainline number at Christchurch Mecklenburg at 262-243-3093 and clicking on option 7 right away. We'd love to pray with you by doing so at that number. If, however, you're not watching live, you're watching later in the week on demand, that's okay. We want to pray for you too. You can go to our website, christchurchmecklenburg.life, and navigate over to our prayer wall and leave a prayer request there. It can be private or it can be public. And if you make it public, you can even see how many times your prayer request has been prayed for. So we'd love to pray with you, whether it's through our mainline number, whether it's through our prayer wall as well. We'd love to pray over you. So do take advantage of that. Thank you once again for joining us in worship here this morning. Our band's going to stick around and play one last song. So feel free to worship for that. We'll see you next week online, and we'll see you August 2nd online or in person.
Grace, God.